Welcome to the Mountain View Christian Church. We're finishing up our series called The Seven Churches. This is the seventh church where Jesus comes and he evaluates these churches. And he says some really good things about these churches, and sometimes he rebukes these churches. Well, the last church is called the Church of Laodicea. He doesn't really have anything that's good to say about them. He actually rebukes them in a very strong way. So I want to give you a little bit of history of this ancient city, because it has some fascinating, there's two things that are fascinating about this city. And Jesus actually uses what they're famous for in his rebuke. So the very first thing is this map right here. You can see, we've looked at the Church of Philadelphia last week, and Sardis, and Thyatira, and Pergamum, and Smyrna, and Ephesus. But this one right here is the last one. It's the Church of Laodicea. Kind of a closer look at it is this one right here. It's right next to a river, but it was also tucked in next to these mountains. And what it was famous for was there was a hot spring up in the mountains. And they would put together an aqueduct system to be able to transport that water from way up in the mountains so they would actually have some hot water for the city. Here's a picture of how it would work. They would have this up in the mountains, and sometimes they would go through and make a tunnel, but they would have this water. It would flow downward toward the city, and it was an aqueduct, and it was fed by the pressure from coming up high down low. Here's an actual picture of some of the aqueduct itself, the pipe that was coming through. I just think that's fascinating to look at that. Here's another picture of one that goes there. And if they had to go across the valley, they would do this high aqueduct system where it would be built across the top here. And the city was famous for bringing this hot water into the city. And people would take baths and they would have fountains and all kinds of stuff. However, there was times where the water would come down and it'd be very, very cold based on the weather. And then there was other times when it would come and it would be what's called lukewarm water. And they would have to reheat it and do whatever they're going to do to the water to make it warmer. So it started out hot. And because of the weather and because of the elements, it would come down to the city and it would be lukewarm. Now Jesus is going to use this as one of his analogies when he's talking about rebuking this city. And they wouldn't understand it because there was the hot springs and the water would come into the city. Sometimes it was hot, sometimes it was cold, but it was also lukewarm. It was also famous for eye ointment. And Jesus is going to use this famous part of this city in his rebuke as well. So if a person had problems with their eyes, they had this special ointment that they would rub onto the eyes and bring about some healing so the person could actually see again. I don't know exactly what kind it was. It was a disease or something, but they would have this ointment and they were famous for it. Here's a jar that was from that period where perhaps they stored some of this ointment there. So let's read the scripture, kind of putting in context the history of this city called Laodicea. And this is what he says. This is our last city. He says this, "And to the angel of the church in Laodicea, this is what is written to them." The words of the Amen. I like that. The words of the Amen. It's the final. It's over. To the words of the Amen, Jesus is saying, he's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the Amen. The faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. He says, "I know your works. I see you. I evaluate you. You are neither cold nor hot." Remember that analogy? They're famous for the hot spring bringing the water in. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit. And that word can be almost this idea of vomit or spew out you out of my mouth. For you say, "I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing." So they're just lukewarm. They weren't passionate about the relationship with Jesus. that are neither cold. And Jesus is saying, I'm going to spew you out. Not realizing that you are wretched, he says. You are poor, you are blind, and you are naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich. White garments, so that you may clothe yourself, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen. And ointment to anoint your eyes so that you may see. I told you that they are famous for this ointment. And Jesus brings it into his analogy there. Jesus said, I want to give you this ointment. I want to open up your eyes so that you may see. Those whom I love, reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Stop being lukewarm. Be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him, and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. And he ends it this way. He says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. May God bless the reading of his word. And so we're going to talk today about this concept of spew or spit or vomit. I came across two little quick things. This is Jay Leno, and he's spitting up water. And then here's another picture kind of helping us understand spitting up. It occurs sometimes in humor. Somebody tells a joke and you're at a table. I've been there. I've seen it. And it comes out. It just kind of spews out. But this is no laughing matter. When Jesus is talking about this, he's saying, I'm going to spew you out. You can't be lukewarm. I'm going to spew. I want you either hot or cold, but not in the middle. I'm going to spew you out. This idea of vomit, it makes him sick. That's pretty strong language. So I'm going to ask this right here, recognizing the signs of a lukewarm Christian. There's four things we want to look at today. Four things. What are the signs? And I know there's probably more, but I just kind of picked four. What are some signs that you can say, that person, maybe even me, I kind of fit into that category of I'm lukewarm, I'm not hot, or I'm not cold. He says this, lukewarm Christians ebb and flow like the waves of the ocean, going nowhere. A lukewarm Christian is not on fire for the Lord. They're not excited about it. They just kind of come and they, and you kind of know what I'm talking about, right? It's that person that has been a Christian for 30 years and you don't really see any change in their behavior. I love going to the Oregon coast. I've shared it with you many a times. I'm down to Puget Sound. It's this driftwood that's right here that gets caught and they just go up and down based on the waves. Just kind of up and down. Here's another picture of a log and the waves are coming in. I have sat there and watched the log just get roll up, then roll back down. They don't really go anywhere. A lukewarm Christian hears the message, but doesn't respond to it. Just kind of ebb it and flow. You might even say that they're infants in their faith, even though they're 30 years into it. Their faith has not grown. Their faith hasn't stretched. Their faith hasn't gotten stronger. Just kind of ebb it and flow. Lukewarm. Jesus says, if you're lukewarm like that, he's going to spew you out of his mouth. I like what Paul says. Then we will no longer be infants, he says. Tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. It's that person who's just blown back and forth. Just following deceptive teachers. That's one of the very first signs of a person who's lukewarm. And Jesus says, I'm going to spew that person out. I'm going to vomit that person out. Here's another one I think is really powerful that we can kind of look at our churches, in particular ourselves. It's this one right here. Recognizing the signs of a lukewarm Christian. Lukewarm Christians love others who love them back. They don't love their enemies. Okay, it's easy to love that person who loves me back, but what about that enemy? A lukewarm Christian struggles with loving that enemy. Jesus said it this way. You've heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. And Jesus comes along, he's going to flip it upside down. He says, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. A lukewarm Christian wants to love those who love them back. But one who's hot and on fire says, I'm going to love everybody. I'm going to love everybody. Love your enemies. I came across this story. It's a really powerful story. One evening in 1944, the bishop spoke in his church, and he spoke out against the persecution of Jews and the deportation of French men as forced laborers. The following night, he was arrested by the Gestapo. He was sent to a detention camp where most prisoners were transported to concentration camps in Germany. Bishop Theos was imprisoned for 10 weeks with Protestants, Jews, non-believers, trade unionists, young resistant officers, and workers. When some prisoners asked for a day retreat, he did this. He was passionate about his faith. He preached about forgiveness and suggested that they should pray for their captors. This provoked an outrage among some of the people that were there. And Theos replied to these people. He said, my friends, I cannot proclaim anything except what the Lord said. Love your enemies, no more, no less. That's what it's about. Is loving our enemies. Passionate people that are not lukewarm love those that are very difficult to love. Mother Teresa said it this way, and I think we can all identify. People are unreasonable, right? Illogical and self-centered. Love them anyway. If we're just loving those that are easy to love, perhaps we're lukewarm. Jesus would come along, he says, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Here's another one I think is really important. He says, when you love your enemies, you reveal what kind of God our God is. I smile because that's our call, is to love God and to love people. The third sign is this one. Lukewarm Christians are afraid to speak the truth. Lukewarm Christians are afraid to stand up for what is right. It's this indifferent spirit. And if we have that attitude, Jesus says, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. I'm going to vomit you out. Here's a sign. Indifference. I've used this quote in the past, but I think it's so good. It's this. The world suffers a lot. Not because of the violence of bad people, but because of the silence of good people. Can I get an amen? When we have an indifference to what is right and what is wrong, we just kind of go along with the flow. I'm not going to say anything. Then perhaps we're lukewarm. And Jesus says, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. I'm going to spit you out. Says this, the only people who are mad at you for speaking the truth are those people who are living a lie. We need to speak the truth. Be passionate about the truth. The scripture says it this way, whoever speaks the truth gives honest evidence, but a false witness utters deceit. And they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully, and you do not care about anyone's opinions. That's the heart of Jesus. He comes along and he goes against the establishment. He goes against the flow because he's going to speak the truth. We are called to speak the truth. I like this. Speak the truth even if your voice shakes. There's many a times where I have been afraid to say something. And even when I start to say it, my voice kind of shakes a little bit. But I know the Holy Spirit is guiding me. Sometimes when I preach, I get a little nervous because I know some people out there are not going to like what God's Word has to say speaking through me. But I made a commitment 30 years ago that I'm going to try to speak the truth because I don't really want to change my message based on what people think about me. So I'm going to speak the truth. And the last one is this one. And I kind of want you to smile at this one because it's true, but it kind of makes us smile. It's this. Lukewarm Christians hear this list and say, the three things I just said, I know someone who is lukewarm and it's not me. I know someone. Immediately, as I'm reading through this, I know that person. They're this way and they're this way and they're lukewarm and they're doing this. But the reality is, I haven't looked at myself. It's the Pharisee who says, I stood by himself and prayed. This Pharisee did. And this is his prayer. God, I thank you that I'm not like, what? I'm not like the other people. Robbers, evildoers, adulterers, lukewarm people. I just kind of throw that in there. Or even like this tax collector, and I can just kind of see him pointing over there. Even like that person over there. Now, I fast twice a week, and I give a tenth of all I get. This Pharisee is a person who's unwilling to look at and evaluate where he's at. He wants to point the finger at somebody else. This says, stop pointing fingers and placing blame on others. Your life can only change to the degree that you accept responsibility for it. Our world would be a better place, just being straight up and honest, if people would stop playing the victim role and really begin to evaluate where they're at. And by the way, I'm kind of guilty of this at times. I kind of look out and go, oh, that person and my situation's bad because of this. No, I need to take a responsibility for myself. Don't judge someone just because they sin differently than you. Jesus said this in John 8, he who is out without sin among you, cast the first stone. These gentlemen, they dragged this lady to Jesus and we caught her in the very act of adultery and they want to stone her and Jesus is there and basically he says, hey, if you're without sin, you cast the first stone. He's trying to get them to evaluate their own personal walk. So today, the question comes down to, are you lukewarm? Are you lukewarm? I know there's times in my life where I'm not so passionate about my relationship with Jesus, and it kind of ebbs and flows. And there's times where I just don't like that person, and I struggle with getting along with that person. And there's some times where I don't stand up for the truth. I get that. Maybe you are as well. But I don't want to be lukewarm. I want to be hot and passionate about my relationship with Jesus. I don't want to be spit out. I don't want to be spewed out. I don't want to be vomited out. I don't want that. And so I'm going to give four questions at the end. These four questions move a person that's being lukewarm to hot. These four questions, and I could have added more, but I wanted to keep it kind of simple. And be passionate about it. The very first one is this. Where did I see God today? If you're asking that question every day, you will be hot. You will not be lukewarm. Because your eyes are going to be open to the power of God. It's a powerful question. Where did I see God today? Did I see God in the sunrise? Did I see God in the kindness of a person? Where do I see God in this question here? What is God trying to teach me? If that's my heart, if that's the question, then I will be hot for Jesus. God, what is it that you're trying to teach me in this circumstance? And the third question is this one. Who can I love that is different than me? Who can I love today? God, I don't want to be lukewarm. Who can I love that is different than me? And the very last question is this one. I think this is a really powerful question. My friend came in the other day. His name is Tom. And he had this question for me. This one right here. What did I do today to make God smile? He said, Bill, what did you do today, to make God smile? That's a great question. Most often, I think the other way. What did I do wrong to make God frown? I wanted to be positive. What did you do today to make God smile? These four questions will help us move from me being lukewarm to being hot. Will you join me in prayer? God, give us the strength and the courage to stand up for what is right. Give us the heart to love people who are different than us. And God, above all, help us to see you and to know you better and be in love with you and be passionate about that. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. May you love God and love people today.